Yes, beta. Let's go to the Indian Music Experience Museum. All your questions will be answered there.
But Ma, I can't wait till the museum reopens.
You don't have to wait till then. Come with me.
But it's not safe outside, Ma.
Don't worry, beta. It's completely safe and sound.
I'm here, Beta. Do you remember the Sarigama that I taught you? Sa. Ri. Ga.
Ma.
Familiar sounds give us comfort, don't they? Strange sounds can make us curious and lead us to new discoveries. Listen to those crickets. How many do you hear? Now, they are a band playing for you. Musical notes are the building blocks of melodies. Just as a few colors can mix in infinite ways to create new stories in new worlds. Many centuries ago, music was created with just two or three notes. It came from a deep longing to connect with the world and beyond. We still hear these notes in the music of different faiths. As civilization grew, so did our music and its range of colors. Our voice was probably the first instrument of music. In time, we found clever ways to make new sounds inspired by nature.
Pandit Ravi Shankar is also known as the godfather of world music. With his sitar, he made the world fall in love with Indian classical music.
Music is the only language I really know, for I believe in Nada Brahma. The sound is God.
Born in Benares to a Bengali family, young Ravi Shankar traveled all over Europe, America and Asia as a dancer and musician in his brother's troupe. This is when young Ravi Shankar learned about Western music. He found his true calling when Baba Alauddin Khan joined the troupe and often trained him. He came back to India at the age of 18 and learned the sitar from Baba for 7 years.
Yehudi Menon and Pandit Ravi Shankar shared a lifelong friendship that resulted in many milestone collaborations in which Menon played Ravi Shankar's compositions based on Indian ragas and rhythms. Through his association with George Harrison, Ravi Shankar's music reached new audiences around the world. Harrison, fascinated by the instrument and the spiritual elements in Indian music, quickly became a devoted student, friend and collaborator. Ravi Shankar tailor-made concert for his Western audience and took the world by storm. His performances in Monterey Pop Festival and Woodstock, among many others, truly made him a global musician. In response to the thunderous applause received during the sound check at the concert for Bangladesh, Ravi Shankar said, "Thank you. If you appreciate the tuning so much, I hope you will enjoy the playing more." Ravi Shankar started his career as a music director with filmmaker Chetan Anand for the movie Neecha Nagar. This was followed by iconic compositions for Satyajit Ray's Appu trilogy, Hrishikesh Mukherjee's Anuradha, Gulzar Saheb's Meera and Richard Attenborough's Gandhi, among many others. Sare Jahan Se Acha was set to a stronger tune by him when he was associated with the Indian People's Theatre Association. While Ravi Shankar created international audiences for Indian classical music, he also introduced other Indian performers to the world stage. He was amongst the first Hindustani musicians to allocate segments within his recitals for tabla solos. He set the world stage for a host of other Indian artists like Ustad Bismillah Khan, Pandit Shiv Kumar Sharma, Ustad Allah Rakha, amongst others. The rich legacy of Pandit Ravi Shankar is being carried forward by modern maestros like Anushka Shankar, Pandit Vishwa Mohan Bhatt, Gaurav Mazumdar, Shubhendra Rao and B.C. Manjunath, among many others.
और वो क्षण भी वैसा ही था जैसा गंगा घाट किनारे जब उसने पूरब को देखा था कि सारे जीवन का सारांश का समागम हो। ऐसे तीव्र क्षण में कौंधता सा सवाल उठा, कौन हूं मैं? क्या अस्तित्व मेरा? कलाकार हूं, वैज्ञानिक हूं, वीर हूं, व्यापारी हूं, मुखिया हूं या सेवक हूं? बाबा जैसे गुरु का मिलना शिष्य का सौभाग्य था। जितने कड़क थे उतने सौम्य भी, जितने ज्ञानी थे उतने प्रेमी भी। बस मन में भाव एक ही रहता कि संगीत की पावनता बनी रहे। रवि ने अपना सितार उठाया और उसे आलिंगन कर आसन पर बैठ गया और इस तरह से उसने फिर कभी पलट कर ना देखा। अपने हुनर की नदी में डुबकी लगाकर कई रागों को जन्म दिया और अपनी जड़ों से जुड़े रहकर संगीत को कई रूपों में निखार दिया। सितार की झनकार ऐसी उठी कि पश्चिम तक स्पंदन जा पहुंचे। हर प्रथा के अपने नियम हैं और हर नियम प्रथा को बनाता है। क्या प्रथा प्रथा रह जाए अगर एक भी नियम छूट जाता है? कैसे ले जाए संगीत को बिना प्रथा को तोड़े? इसलिए रवि शंकर जी ने दुनिया के हर कोने में पूरी सच्चाई से अपने संगीत को सुनाया, लोगों के हृदय तक पहुंचाया और सबको शामिल कर लोगों के विचारों में जगह बनाई।
मां, यू कीप कंफ्यूजिंग मी। समटाइम्स यू से हिंदुस्तानी क्लासिकल, समटाइम्स इंडियन क्लासिकल, आर दे द सेम?
नो बेटा, Indian classical music comprises of Hindustani classical that originated in the northern parts of the country and Carnatic classical that originated in the southern parts of the country.
Oh, so which came first, ma? Hindustani or Carnatic?
That's a very interesting question. At one point of time, Dhrupad in North India and Carnatic classical in South India coexisted. And even if you look at it now, you see a lot of similarities. The singer would maintain the taal himself, the use of the pakhavaj or the mridangam, and they follow the vocal music rather than play the theka or the taal, the syllables. So these are all common things between Dhrupad and Carnatic music, which forces me to believe that at one point of time, the whole of India had one kind of music which had both the elements of Dhrupad as well as Carnatic. So I think Dhrupad music was sung in the temples, and there were court musicians who were really good at Dhrupad. The present Hindustani classical music that we hear is an amalgamation of various forms of music. So because of the Mughal invasions, they brought along with them their culture, Arabic, there was Turkish, there was Persian, the languages also came, their culture also came, and their music also came. And some of the instruments were modified, the Indian instruments like the Veena and Mridangam, Pakhavaj, they all were changed. There was a revolution that took place, and then the Pakhavaj became the tabla, and then the sitar was invented. and then a lot of lyrics were written in praise of the kings. Earlier, whether it is South Indian music or North Indian music, the lyric was mostly about gods. So that way, the music in India flourished in different ages. You know, if you look at the history, Dhrupad then gave birth to Bhakti movement, and there were a lot of saint poets who started singing in praise of gods, and then there was a lot of folk music that crept into this form of music. And in the South India, we had the Purandardasaru, and then the Trinity of Carnatic classical music. They all contributed to the evolution of the present day Carnatic music. And then there was a lot of scientific approach also. Venkatmukhi classified the ragas into 72 melakartas, and so on and so forth. So, I think it is important as a musician to understand that Dhrupad was is the oldest form in northern part, whereas the present day Carnatic music that we hear had its root in the southern part of music, and probably they coexisted at one point of time. But it is difficult to say which one came first. But I think we should just enjoy the music.
Ma, you told me so many things about Tansen. He was a Hindustani classical musician?
Yes, beta. But his guru Swami Haridas was a disciple of Purandaradasa, who is called the Pitamaha of Carnatic classical music.
Why was he called the Pitamaha, Ma?
ತಾರಕ ಬಿಂದಿಗೆ ನಾನೀರಿಗೆ ಹೋಗುವೆ ತಾರೆ ಬಿಂದಿಗೆಯ ತಾರಕ ಬಿಂದಿಗೆ ನಾನೀರಿಗೆ ಹೋಗುವೆ ತಾರೆ ಬಿಂದಿಗೆಯ ಬಿಂದಿಗೆ ಒಡೆದಾರೆ ಒಂದೇ ಕಾಸು ಬಿಂದಿಗೆ ಒಡೆದಾರೆ ಒಂದೇ ಕಾಸು ತಾರೆ ಬಿಂದಿಗೆಯ ತಾರೆ ಬಿಂದಿಗೆಯ ತಾರಕ ಬಿಂದಿಗೆ ನಾನೀರಿಗೆ ಹೋಗುವೆ ತಾರೆ ಬಿಂದಿಗೆಯ ತಾರಕ ಬಿಂದಿಗೆ ನಾನೀರಿಗೆ ಹೋಗುವೆ ತಾರೆ ಬಿಂದಿಗೆಯ
ಪುರಂದರದಾಸ ಆಸ್ ವಿ ಆಲ್ ನೋ ಇಸ್ ದ ಪಿತಾಮಹ ಆಫ್ Carnatic music, and he's inspired me with his words, because his words are biblical, to say so, because it's like a dictionary for human nature. All his words are still relevant to today's times. All his words are very, very contemporary. So I think it's like truth. When truth, you know that this Earth revolves around the sun. That's the truth, and there is nothing you can change about it. So he talks about human behavior, human philosophy, relationships, about love, about hatred, and about all other aspects and emotions of humanity. So it's like the whole universe has been described through his words. So that's why I feel like he's one of the best poet of all times, and his words are what inspires me to make my music. So I just see what feeling comes out of me, and I create it the way that I feel it is doing to me, and that's what it should do to the audience as well. And hence we call it indie folk rock fusion or contemporary folk rock fusion, because of the simplicity of his words. And so even the complex subject he tells in a very simplistic way. That's what I really related to. And also when I did Ragi Tandira, my thought was, how did Purandaradasa go and spread his words to people. There was no social media, there's no Instagram or Facebook at, in those times. So he would actually go out there and amongst people sing those songs, tell the meaning and have a discussion. So music was a social gathering. Music was a social discussion about whatever is happening in the society. So that's when I felt, okay, maybe I should try that again, because of course, after I did that whole thing, it again came back to social media. It came on YouTube, it came on Instagram and things. But I did have that experience of going to different places, making people sing those words. The reception was really positive and very welcoming. And I think that is the power of those words and music, power of music that makes people interact, make people come together. And I always feel I'm blessed that somehow I'm able to understand little bit of his words and probably do my bit to his contribution to the world of music.
It started raining, ma. Isn't this the rag you taught me the other day?
Yes, beta. Rag Megh Malhar.
So do we have ragas for other seasons as well?
When I was approached with the concept of Samay Chakra, I had to choose ragas that represented the different times of the day. Actually, we have a system called Prahar. There are various Prahars and each Prahar is for 3 hours. So there are 8 Prahars, 8 Prahar. So there are ragas which fall into each of these Prahars. Per se, Samay Chakra is again a ragmala or a garland of ragas being presented one after the other. But Samay Chakra was very challenging because I had to restrict my ideas to a few seconds. So that was quite challenging for me. We realized that no one has done something like this before. To concise the whole story of Samay Chakra into a few minutes. And then it should run as a loop. So the whole idea of bringing this story in front of people and making them understand that in Hindustani classical music we have ragas for various times of the day, and then yet making it a very interesting, intriguing, worked rigorously on this project that we could come up with the end product, and I'm sure all of you are going to enjoy this. So I began the cycle in the early morning with the Lalak or Lalit. And then Bibhas is another beautiful raga which is associated with the sunrise. Bibhas then Bhairav, a morning, late morning. Afternoon ragas like Vrindavani Sarang with Deepalas. Evening raga Marwa. Then night raga Bihar. Mm-hmm.
And I also used Miyaki Malhar, which is a seasonal raga, which represents the rainy season. Midnight Raga, Darbari. And then I concluded it with Bhairavi, which has been the norm in all the Hindustani classical music concerts.
Ma?
Why don't we ask the person who made it, Beta?
There is no precedence, I don't know, for any piece of audiovisual experience which has been presented in this format. That was challenging, interesting, fascinating, and very, very exciting. Hi, this is Indrajit Natoji. I had the privilege of creating two beautiful film installations for the Indian music experience. One was the introductory film Nadam and the other one was Samay Chakra, both audio-visual immersive experiences. As visuals change, the ragas representing that time of day and mood also change seamlessly into one beautiful, continuously playing eternal track. Cue of the beginning of the film is the beginning of a day. And the day ends with the night. So that's the only cue that the film has ended or begun. But actually, it keeps going on and on and on like time. Like the Samay Chakra, the wheel of time. One of the most challenging brief, the brief was we have to create an audiovisual experience or a film which encapsulates the story of Indian music or the evolution of Indian music in 5 minutes. Where do we start? How do we end? What do we do in the middle? It was extremely intimidating, and sometimes you have to go extremely basic and simple to address something so complex as Indian music. That's how it all connected, and that's how I got the idea of a mother reassuring her child who's waking up in the middle of the night.
Ma,
with so many sounds.
Sounds scared.
Create the personality of silence.
There's so many sounds keeping me awake.
Do you remember the sarigama that I taught you?
Basic sound of a car honking. And it has a pitch, it has a melody, it has a note. And what is that note? You identify it as sa. Pa pa pa. Then you have a cat. Meow. That's a note. So that's where I started developing the idea of mother explaining to a child that every sound is music, and then taking her on a journey of that experience. And we touch upon all the various layers and the forms of Indian music, from folk to sounds of nature to, and how we as human beings got inspired by all the sounds around us and created such beautiful, complex melody and music. And I wanted to have the music first and then we visualize on the music. So we created a kind of a radio edit, meaning from the basic sound to sound as notes, to notes as melodies, to melodies as folk, nature, to Hindustani classical, to Carnatic, to Bollywood, to popular music. You know, that whole entire thing, it was first we did a radio edit. We don't have the luxury to use regular film language. Then I devised something called artistic rotoscopy, you shoot something and then you, frame by frame, you paint over it. So I shot the characters of Shruti and Ma. Uh, Nadam introduces the entire museum space. Elements of Nadam are reflected all over the museum if you see. So yes, it was something completely new. And I don't think anybody has seen this, so all of you need to come and experience that.
Why isn't this radio working? I listened to it only yesterday.
Tell me which song you want to listen. I'll play it on my phone.
It's not the same, Beta.
Why is it not the same, Ma?
Born out of Thomas Alva Edison's desire to record telephone conversations, the phonograph was going to change the world of music forever. Now, I would like a special guest to share his thoughts.
Hey, down here. That's better. It was in the year 1887 when the phonograph gave way to the gramophone. I was born, exactly how you see me today. In the years to come, I traveled extensively, capturing the beautiful voices of this nation.
Unfortunately, some men took the word
capture quite literally.
What do you mean quite literally?
Well, they thought their voices would be stolen if they recorded into the gramophone and hence considered it beneath them.
It's called HMV, His Master's Voice. If so many men resisted, whom did you record?
Well, India heard the lost voice of women through the gramophone. Exponents like Gauhar Jan, Mangalore Thai were extensively recorded during this time. Soon, the gramophone became a household name and HMV turned India into the world's largest producer of gramophone records.
Largest producer of music records? That must have made you extremely popular among the masses.
No, it was actually the radio that won their hearts. So tell me, what made you so popular?
The news bulletin, sports commentary, Vadya Vrinda, and iconic shows like Amin Sayani's Binaka Geet Mala.
Yeah, I think the most important thing is that you brought people together. But then again, what do you think about the new kids on the block? I mean, everyone is wired into their own music. Technology has almost made music a conversation barrier nowadays.
You're right. Mobile phones and streaming sites have indeed made music a personal affair.
But tell me this, while the technology transformed, I perished. But I see that the radio is still here. Do you think that the radio holds its charm though?
Remember the days when you turned on the radio and it played a song you hadn't heard in years? You remember the feeling of being in love for the first time? Or dedicating songs to your special someone anonymously? You remember the rainy days with a plate of piping hot bhajis or waiting for everyone to hear your favorite song? When was the last time you did that?
Now, listen to the silence between the heartbeats. There is no music without silence. Can you hear it? That's music too.